Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to our 52nd CCS meeting. Very happy to have Dr. Ruzzenenti, all the way from Groningen. So he was born in Brescia and graduated in Siena in environmental economics before going to the University of Oxford, where he studied biology and chemistry, and then he received his PhD in environmental chemistry. So he specializes in energy markets, environmental economics, complex systems, and network theories. He contributed to several books, which is the reason that we invited him here today. So very interested to hear his thoughts on, you know, the nexus between environmental economics, energy markets, and the tools the complex systems might help to solve this transition. Thank you very much, Franco. I'll pass the floor to you.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you for inviting me. Well, I have to say that I will not talk about energy markets today. I will talk more at the an epistemological talk. But I think that you find it interesting, however, although I think that some of the ideas that I come up with today can be used also to understand the entanglement between energy markets, energy systems, and society. But first of all, I would like not for the sake of proselytism, but for the sake of possible future cooperation to introduce our center and group. I basically belong to the Energy Research Center of Groningen, is this beautiful building in the campus, Groningen, Zernike campus, with more or less 20 professors, Utrecht professors, some 75 PhD students. It's a very interdisciplinary research center. We kind of develop or design three overarching things for the idea also integrating these different fields of research and study. I chair, I lead one of the three teams, the geophysical economy and circular resource systems. Don't ask me what does that mean,
the people online can't see too much.
Can you speak to my screen share the screen? Yes. No problem. Anyway, you did not lose anything so far. You're still in the preambles. As I said, it's a very interdisciplinary group. Go from geoenergy. Well, the groups essentially belong to our research center is biomimetics, geoenergy, center for isotope research, essentially on carbon isotopes and so pollution and climatology, and the conversion group, nuclear energy, and our group, which is the group that I belong to, the IRIS, Integrated Research on Energy, Environment and Society, which is the more interdisciplinary group in the interdisciplinary research center. We have economists, physicists, engineers, and also with a background in social studies. And we do, differently from the others, they do lab research, we do desk research. So models, essentially, mostly models. And well, also, I think that my presence here, and my presence in Ukraine, deserves credit to the late Hera Daikima, which designed a really strange call for the position at IRIS, which was essentially meant to bring into the study of energy systems the field of let's say complex system theories. And he clearly mentioned the focus shall not be of modeling energy industrial systems as dynamic methods, which caught immediately my attention when I was reading the code. And unfortunately, I did not have the chance to meet him because he passed away before I was appointed. But the call was designed by the call, my position was designed by him. And I suggest this, it's a nice paper, that's the 2.0. I have also energy complexity Nexus, which is, I believe, the original. Knowledge at least is original, to the extent that a student from Utrecht University came last year to attend the course, a brilliant student. He did a, I have to say, a really nice assignment, Res Barman. And now he's doing his master in somewhere in the United States, the master thesis, and he's applying him. Because I thought it was basically for him that I was it was his fault, but then I contacted him and he told me that the emphatically he's using the methods that I learned at your course little gratification. But let's go to the topic of this talk after this brief introduction. And I would like brief butterfly overview of the topic of the energy transition. Let's call it the phenomenology of energy transition. Well, first of all, energy transition is accompanying mankind since the inception. It's nothing new. Mankind has gone through many energy transition, although the time scale of energy transition also huge that most of the generation did not perceive it. So it goes beyond the scope of one's life. Nevertheless, still it's ongoing energy transition. There are in the world, there are regions of the world that are still in the course of an energy transition from wood. Africa essentially is still a very mass-based economy in terms of primary energy. So, as a matter of fact, they're still moving away from biomass while they're trying to move it back to biomass. Interesting paradox. Although, let's say, all we are a generation that did not experience the big form of energy transition from coal to oil. Nevertheless, it's embedded even in our culture, the energy transition or the past energy dominant systems. Well, I found reading Pinocchio to my daughter, I found, for example, this interesting calorimetric equivalent of Pinocchio, which was in terms of wood, was equivalent to one pot of beans. I don't know if this too, but my feeling that was pretty good, you know, because quite a lot of wood. Anyway, and energy transition is not only part of mankind or history, it's part of biological history. And as a matter of fact, it's for example, because some energy transition, like the great oxidation of coal, that now mankind exists. So let's say that it's not something new, energy transition and climate change as well. And again, although we still have this idea, there is this widespread feeling, I think, or this is my perception, that it's a complete novelty energy transition. It's not a novelty in man's history, but not even a novelty in our, let's say, culture, in our intellectual background. Historians, or let's say good historians, they always, at least since the last 2 centuries, interpreted great economic and social changes in terms of energy. For example, according to Brodel, that was written in the 50s, was indeed very optimistic in the last big energy transition that could be energy, no? industrial revolution is a sequence of great energy transition, steam, internal combustion, and steam, electricity, internal combustion, and nuclear energy. For the last one, it was really wrong. And what is important is that he maintains, one of the greatest historians, maintains that it's not even possible to talk about industrial revolution properly, industry, properly speaking, before the advent of the steam engine. There was not real industry, pre-industry. And indeed, a change was unprecedented, indeed, with respect to the whole past energy transition. Not for the first time in human history, combustion was used to produce mechanical work. That's amazing. That's not only in human history, but in biological history as well, as a matter of fact. Combustion used to produce mechanical work, mechanical within the physical terms, no? The change of status or matter, essentially. And well, this is a well known graph, what did this bring about in energy transition? So, this is something that we have already explained. This is something that it's embedded in our culture. Nevertheless, it's something that generates anxiety, fear, hopes. Well, perhaps one reason of this anxiety is that, as a matter of fact, we do want. So it's the first time that this energy transition is a sentient process. It's a product of a deliberation. Collective deliberation is something that we want. Formerly, energy transition was the outcome of the onset of a new technology, essentially, and the surface of the new technology as a kind of selective process, no? Nature, to a certain extent, no? Now we want this energy transition for the sake of nature. At the same time, it's an energy transition that goes against nature for the first time. And I suggest, if you want to delve more into this topic, to read Vakrasmith, the greatest energetic, living energetic, in my opinion, and one of the very few intellectuals on this topic that is worth reading. For example, most of his work describes how, on a very long time scale, all the energy transition is essentially a succession of more powerful devices, so more power available to economy and society, and also, most importantly, more energy density, more power or power density, properly speaking, or power intensity. So over the unit of volume or over the unit of surface. And in terms of scale, and indeed, we know that one of the biggest problems of the energy transition is that our society and our economy, it relies on power, on a density of power of some one or two order of magnitude higher than those of renewable energy. This gap, this power gap, it's an issue. And perhaps this is also why it generates anxiety. It is, I think, that is maybe not, there is not a full awareness of this, but there is a general understanding. It is perceived of this, that we are going to something completely different and somehow against nature. Or let's say the nature of evolution.
So basically you mean to maintain your energy consumption, you need to expand spatial. But
exactly, we'll go on that maybe later in discussion if you want. It means exactly this. We consume much more space than we think. Well, change and evolution has always been our being advantage. Big changes. And we have always taken this uncertainty with predictive modeling. That is a nice record on this predictive modeling. But what's important that here, for example, our old from the 30s or 60s, no? when the problem of carbon, of coal was depletion of coal was becoming the stringent. But what is important is that forecasting was needed for both to reduce uncertainty to a certain extent, no? But also to save the view of the future. So it had both a descriptive function, but also a prescriptive, normative function. Because you know, with this graph, with the extrapolation, give you the idea of where we are heading to, where we must head to higher energy consumption, obviously. It's interesting, for example, if you go really, there is a beautiful record. I spent some time in studying this, the record of failures, fiascos in predictions, and so the RAND Corporation. RAND Corporation is one of the most important advisors still now, think tank advisor, Pentagon, and White House, a big corporation. No? That nowadays we should be already in the age of general repetitive immunization, genetic programming for the elimination of hereditary defects and the chemical physical therapy of mental illness. This is ominous. Thankfully, we are not there, I must say. But what's most funny is that we expect to have a complete, there will be a control on a regional basis of the weather conditions. This is even ironic. But now, if we Marchetti demands some attention, because Marchetti, Cesare Marchetti, and then physicist, was the one who developed one of the most famous and at that time successful models to predict energy transition. And indeed, his model, I'm not going to explain how this model works, but it's very simple. It's a pre-predicted model, essentially, based on logistic functions. And essentially, this model contribute to the knowledge of energy transition with the idea that energy transition follows so-called conductive waves, long waves, no, in the order of decades, centuries, no? And then, the most important, according to this model, that energy transition goes, to use his word, unscoupled by any underlying phenomena, social, economic, wars, no matter what, energy transitions are unstoppable. Hmm? Yes, pretty deterministic model. And indeed, it worked very well. At that time in the 70s, it did explain very well the decline of oil production, the onset, the uprising of gas production, and of course in an ecstasy of determinism, Marchetti said the whole testing of an energy source seems to be completely predetermined in the first childhood. Indeed, it gave an important relief to the answer that Marchetti was a physicist at gas, was one of the most important sustainable energy world, global, international energy center. And he predicted that the basically the gas would have replaced oil, and then also with a delay in the phase of 50 years, nuclear energy eventually take over on gas. Well, nothing was for a model than a good prediction. That's really the end, a perfect prediction. This is perhaps it's the fate of models, no? The self-fulfillment prophecy, no? When your model works. And indeed, it did work only for slightly longer than a decade. Oil never faded away. Actually, in the last years, it's growing. Nuclear energy stopped growing in the 90s and is actually declining. Coal, that is the most detrimental phenomenon to the poor Marchetti, was coal. Coal never disappeared. It went into this kind of steady state, oscillating steady state, but never disappeared. Reality is much more complex than this, the model. And this is why, for perhaps, we are increasingly recruiting complex system theory to address this issue. Well, first of all, or let's say an epistemic need, because typically we have in the base in this topic deep uncertainty with regard to boundaries, the boundaries of the system, we don't know exactly what it means, the relationship, the number, the nature, all the radius of this relationship, the causality, causality chain, and even the direction, the idea of set organizations, reversibility, complexity, most of the reality, the opaque and complex systems. Well, are things that you know probably even better than you know, than the dynamics, the functional form, no? The non-linearity that we're using. We know very often the number of the components, the dimension of the system, therefore the degree of freedom that we have to employ. And most importantly, the structure of these relationships. But perhaps it's not just the epistemic problem. And this is the case that I want to make today. It's also an epistemological problem. In that, perhaps there is something inherently different in complexity. That it's elusive. So it's not just the complete information, the lack of complete information. It's also something that is specific on complex systems. Indeed, new approaches, they try to embody some of complexity concept into the methodology. Here it's a nice review, pretty recent, a measure of new economies energy transition models review. And well, they do embrace some kind of complexity, some sort of complex system theory, in the way, in the sense that typical, for example, non-linearity, they have some in the functional form they use for also non-linear equations sometimes, in the fact that they are typically interdisciplinary, which is specific, so the so-called integrated assessment, they take an integrated approach to the problem. And also that typically they are non-reversible. The idea is that they change, they are path dependent, no? And then essentially are based on two main approaches. The one is the system dynamics modeling and agent-based modeling, essentially. Then the other are econometrics, the usual econometrics model, so not much of a novelty. Another important paper, or one of the most cited papers that deals with the problem and a complex system theory applied to energy is this one the most cited. And again, even here, they make probably more refined and complete analysis of all the of all the approaches that have been employed so far to understand, to study energy system with the view of complex system theory. And they effectively summarize there are three different approaches. Again, equation-based models, computational equilibrium model, optimization models, or system dynamics models. Agent-based models, or network theory. Well, I also had my venture in agent-based model, thanks to my brilliant students, I have to say, that are much more competent than mine writing codes. And this is our agent-based model of the Dutch electricity sector to test this model for energy storage capacity. And I'm not going to dive into this if you want, if you're interested. This is the paper, and this is the structure of the model, which has essentially a physical grid underlying that, which is the transmission grid, and the various agents. Well, this is like obviously the calibrating phase in which we predicted the electricity, the price of electricity markets, calibrated our model. And this is when it's easy to be misled about the agent-based model. I don't know if you came across agent-based modeling. My point is that very often agent-based models are confusingly considered predictive models. And here it's easy. It's such a beautiful tradition of electricity drive. It's easy to be misled into this misconception of HMS models. And still now they are considered predictive models. But they are not. They are descriptive. And you see that once obviously you analyze the results, the outcome. Typically, what you do, here we produce 50,000 possible scenarios, essentially, not possible combinations of depending on the setting, on the initial setting of the model. And therefore, it's really difficult for me to convey the message that, because at the end, what they have, but yes, but so what? Is a business on energy storage profitable in the Netherlands or not? No, I don't know. What we are doing here is describe in a systematic way the interaction of agents and to see what are the possible outcomes, therefore, how they interact. This is what I meant for agent. Describe this interaction in a control. A closed environment. And here I would like to make a point because I'm not passionate of agent-based model. I think that agent-based model should be used only when the behavior of agents is anthropomorphic, to use the words of George Sturgeon, great physicist, that can be really explained by an algorithm. I don't like to explain the behavior of a human being with an algorithm. A company, yes, you can, net present value. Eventually, it's very simple, it's an algorithm, and if the space of interaction is closed, so no new agents, I would say it is an ergodic system, essentially. But I know that this is disputed, so let's say a closer environment, no new agents, no new rules on interactions, and also no external factors. And then you can run your GPS model. In my view, the electricity market, it is like that, you can do it, for example. And that's why it's interesting for me. But complexification and uncertainty is really because the ambition of reducing uncertainty, making models more complex, it actually gives completely the opposite result. And perhaps this is good. Here, it's a nice paper, recent, I think this year. Which they
a few weeks ago,
it's a really beautiful paper. I suggested to reading that, and indeed they show, let's say analytically, they show that increasing the dimension and the interaction of models bring on just more uncertainty, and I think it's good. You have to be happy with that. It doesn't mean that if you have more uncertainty, you have less information. But the main question, but I would like to go back to this epistemological issue. By making models more sophisticated and complex, do we really depart from mechanics paradigm? Well, so now we must address the question of complexity. Because obviously, because a question of paradigm, we have to discuss about this. This is one of the most mentioned papers to deal with the concept of complexity. It is actually the same one that is used and mentioned by this this paper. I think it's a really scant and poor analysis of what type of complexity you can have. And I think it's much more useful to say, I mean, not lingering this, the approach of Elkhart Morin, a philosopher. I think it would nice things about complexity that I suggest. And the idea essentially that use completely improperly, the term restricted and general complexity, obviously it's wrong. But nevertheless, the idea is that restricted is an epistemic issue. General is an epistemological issue. So when you approach complexity and epistemological issue, you are searching for something inherent in the system. It's not just a lack of information. And then, so where is the conflict between complexity and mechanics? Why complexity departs from mechanics? Or is unreconcilable with mechanics? Well, most of the mechanics, I don't know many of you studied physics.
I did.
Don't mention my CV.
I also studied physics.
In the kinetic theory of matter and all of the important results achieved by it, we recognize the realization of the general philosophical program according to which the explanation of all phenomena is reduced to the interaction between elementary particles. This is a beautiful book of Einstein that I suggest. It's a beautiful building. The revolution the revolution of Einstein for him in the history of physics is the introduction of theory, the Maxwell, essentially. A new concept, the most important invention since the Newton's time, is introduced in physics, and that is the concept of field. The idea that the particle, in the case of Maxwell charge particle, modify the space. It's not the interaction between particles that defines the pattern in the model, but it's the modification, the change of space. What approach, my view, and I will now, let's say, prove a lot in favor of my favorite approach to complexity, what approach mimics this change of space, or at least is consistent with this paradigm in the field of complex system theory, is network theory essentially studies that how the space of interaction changes in relation to elements distribution. And every new element potentially changes the symmetry of the space. It's the study of the space of interaction, essentially, network. And it's interesting because, again, another thing that I remember from my study of mechanics, that once the professor told me that the main assumptions of mechanics is the homogeneity of space. Of course, otherwise you cannot integrate the space over time and vice versa. You don't have conservation of energy, essentially. But then we live in a world in which there is no homogeneity of space. Our interactions, the space, if I go in this direction, I have a road, I go faster than if I go in this direction, I have a wall. And network theory, in my view, it's about this, essentially. I now will quickly show some of the words that we do, in which we use network theory in relation, obviously, to energy studies. Just to give you an idea of why I believe network theory is important to understand this. To understand change in the energy system, structural change in the energy system. Well, for example, you study the topology of economic and ecological networks. It's really interesting. Here, for example, we study the cycles of trade, and it's interesting how it's correlated up to 85%, anti-correlated to oil price, historically. No? So basically, oil price determines the metabolic, the pneuma of trade in terms of cycles. Or also studied in economic, in physical and socio-economic networks, in more than 100 electronic networks, studied how cycles are related to different properties, several network properties, and found interesting that the most correlated property is reciprocity. This is, I think, it's somehow fascinating. The more reciprocated is a network, mutuality, the more likely you have cycles. I think this is really important for the sake of circular economy, but nobody thinks. But I think it's really interesting perspective because obviously it's on a purely theoretical ground. We're talking about the structural property of the system. Other possible applications, modeling, investigating the nexus among different types of flows, Here it's a paper that we did on compare virtual land, virtual water, energy, CO2, financial and hydrogen flows, for example, around the world, and how are correlated. Or also modeling the rebound effect. How modeling exactly how the homogeneity space change in relation to natural properties. Other applications that we are developing, for example, mapping actors network in the digital phase. This we did is in relation to the energy transition, that was the keyword we used to map all the actors involved in the energy transition in the Netherlands and their relationship. And also, we look at the topic, what they discuss. In the hyperlink network or in Twitter network, and then you get an idea, no, if they are so-called eco-chambers, if they are communicating or not. But here, I understand that still we haven't answered the main engineering question. I think the epistemological question: what is complexity and what is important for the energy generation? Why is it important to understand the nexus between complexity and energy? We typically give granted what is more complex or less complex, no? That is this famous sentence of Bertrand Russell, no? We are more complex than amoeba, but we never has the amoeba with. If I type complexity type complexity in some engine, this is not Google, this is I think Bing. This will be complexity, no? And indeed, it's also the definition, for example, of Chasson. Complexity, state of intricacy, complication, involvement. And this is the idea of density permeated our perception of complexity. A dense space, organized, but intricate, dense. About this. So can we start from this idea that a salient property of complexity is density? To understand, to try to investigate these nexus. Vakrasmir from the book, this one, students always notice the sentence and they are always old, and every year we have a discussion of these simple figures provided by Vakrasmir. The South power intensity averages about 200 nanowatt per gram, but the daily metabolism of Fukushima proceeds at the rate of 3 microwatt. Programming a body weight, so of body weight. So basically, it's 50,000 times more power intense than the sun. Amazing. And it's true. never meddle with numbers with Vakrasmir. It's a volcano of numbers, Vakrasmir. And indeed, if you go, the energy density rate, so say joule for second for gram, no? Energy density rate, mass units in this case, can be done in mass or volume, doesn't matter, of course. But indeed, if you look at the historical record, always increasing in the evolutionary record from what is the gymnosperm, angiosperm, and more evolutive plants, no? In animals as well, so multicellular organisms. In society, energy density of people in the society from hunter-gatherers, industrialists, technologists, I don't know what they mean, but in the past. And same with technological devices. So, is this a law of evolution? Chasson, that I mentioned earlier, claims it is. And he even goes as far as claiming that it does not only concerns human artifact. But concerned is a cosmologist from Harvard, as a paper, not very famous. I don't know him as a cosmologist, but he developed this theory, the idea that there is this is the general law of evolution, that essentially energy density increases with complexity. And actually, he maintains that complexity should be taken, energy density rate should be taken as a matrix for complexity. I think it's circular, I would say it's completely wrong, maybe we have to understand why. No? What is complexity and why energy density increases with complexity? And also, this general law of evolution is not supported. We have also contrasting trends in the evolution. Sometimes the energy density decreases with evolution. So it's not perfect, but we all know the perfect laws. Hmm? But what is important is that, for example, in biology, this is well known. And typically is explained by the fact that it's Darwinian, no? It's the result of selection, hyper-selection. You select either the fastest or the most efficient organism, therefore, no? More energy becomes available to the ecosystem, and that's why you increase. But why the feast should be more complex? Also, and if Chasson is right. Well, there is no selective pressure. I think it. I have to say that for me, this is the most fascinating, one of the most fascinating questions of all physics, I should say, or if you prefer, of science, that is still there to be answered, to be addressed. And I think that it does have a lot to do with energy transition. There are now that was in the 70s, 80s, and now it's a little bit faded away. I think this is in the early 90s, this work. This was a topic that was highly investigated, researched. I could mention many contributions from people who won the Nobel, no, but essentially from a complexity, entropy. There are several others. I like very much this contribution Schneider and Kay, which is isolated, it stays there. No? It did not really start a line of research, unfortunately. And the thing that they somehow do is to reverse the causality chain. We always think, as I said before, no, that essentially a more complex system, more complex organism consumes more energy because it needs more energy. So the idea selective process makes more complex, tend to select more complex structures, and this, therefore, they consume more energy because they need more. And they revert the causality. It's more energy that to dissipate needs more complex systems in the paper. And I always find really intriguing because it's indeed deterministic, but it's, at least it's not teleological to this problem. I will go back to finish on this. We don't have much time, so we run quickly to the words in which we tackle, to show you the words in which we tackle more in depth the nexus between complexity and energy. Here we use a model that we develop based on we develop a new approach to random weighted motives, sorry, through random walks networks to understand the complexity of economic systems and how they relate to energy. And indeed, if you look at, because there is a huge feature of complexity of the production space, but none of these matrix they show any correlation with the energy density. And I'm happy to say that our approach here shows some correlation, energy complexity. But we don't have time to talk about this. Other things that relate to this is the automatic scaling that we are investigating corporations and try to investigate this idea of energy, density, corporation, and complexity, which essentially is based on the same principle of evolution in nature. And finally, eventually, and conclude, we also try to apply the maximum energy production principle to networks. I don't know if you know the maximum energy production principle theory. It's, as a matter of fact, a really old theory. And it's more or less a analytical machinery that try to explain what was intuitively found by Schneider and Kay. The idea exactly is that under certain external, under certain conditional external constraints, the relation between cause and the response of the system, of non-equilibrium system, which is here, it goes in the direction to maximum energy production. And there is also a information theory based theoretical framework to do this. And this is what we lastly are trying to do to networks. The idea to develop basically a maximum energy production function of for networks and to see how if you are able to mimic the essentially the degradation, no, from a highly concentrated network like in a block matrix to a highly random chaotic network, if we basically see if our function, entropy production function, can reproduce a pure chaotic rewilding, random rewilding of the network, and it does pretty well. I like it. But I'm not satisfied because still the hypothesis based on this model is that essentially randomization in a network, or let's say the energy dissipates, and the line idea is the energy in the network dissipates by randomly throwing away links. But I think that the next step I want to do is change this hypothesis space with a preferential attachment. The idea that energy dissipates by attaching, so developing a link, moving a link to a more connected hub, kind of attractor. And I think that in that case, probably our map function would emulate a complex network condition, deep slow. Well, that would be really interesting because then we can think about complex networks as a series of mechanical links. Not with the idea of organization, entropy, the idea that organization is the reduction of entropy. Perhaps it's not. Perhaps it's another form of mechanical entropy that we don't have yet the analytical framework to understand. This is purely philosophical, that is still in the course, still in warm of gods, but. This is it. I will give you this last